Recording in progress. Good afternoon, everybody. Am I audible?
Yes, it is. You may proceed.
Okay. Good afternoon once again. I am very happy to be able to start this session of Dialogic today. Our speaker today is Dr. Balachandran from the Department of Environmental Studies. May I now request my colleague, Dr. Sharmishika Maiti, to introduce the speaker today. Sharon.
Thank you, Vipashadi. Good afternoon, everyone. Today, we are really extremely delighted to have Dr. S. Balachandran in this forum of Young Scholars lecture series. Let me take the opportunity to introduce Dr. S. Balachandran in front of our esteemed audience. Dr. S. Balachandran is an associate professor in the Department of Environmental Studies, Shiksha Bhavana. He has completed a total of 5 research projects funded by agencies like UGC, DST, DBT, BBSRC UK, whereas several collaborative researches were done with University of Exeter, University of Leeds, University of Sheffield, University of Nottingham in UK. Moreover, further collaborations were also carried out within country with the institutes like Institute of Chemical Technology, Mumbai, IIT Mumbai, IIT Madras, Tejpur University, to name a few. He has published more than 30 research articles in peer-reviewed journals. Presently, he is engaged in the research of biogas enhancement using physical, chemical, and biological pre-treatment of lignocellulitic feedstock like aquatic weeds, water hyacinth, salvinia, which can be used by the common people for biogas production. This practice would not only keep the ponds clean, but also subsequently provide the renewable energy as well. Utilization of biochar to increase biogas production is also being investigated by Dr. Balachandran. Pretty recently, he has started working on 2-stage dark fermentation for production of biohyacinth using biomass and food waste as feedstock. Today, he is going to deliver a talk on renewable energy, biogas, and its barriers in rural India. We are very eager to listen to you, sir. So the screen is yours. Very welcome, Dr. S. Balachandran. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Ishika. So let me just share my screen. Is the screen visible?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Yeah, okay, let me just...
Yes, it's perfect, okay. Sir.
Yeah. Fine. Yeah. Respected Honorable Upacharya, Professor, and my dear students, good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to the Visva-Bharati Young Scholars Lecture Series today. I would be discussing about the renewable energy, basically biogas and its barriers in rural India. So I should thank Professor Bibhasha Raha and Dr. Sudev Pratinda, who told me to give a popular science lecture. So since I'm working on various physical, chemical, and biological pretreatment of aquatic feeds for enhancement of biogas, particularly the methane content, I visited the nearby villages in Shantiniketan, basically near Golpara, and a particular village called Uttar Shehlai. There, I was shocked to see there the actual situation, that is, there are a total 8 biogas plant and 8 are not working. So I started inquiring them why it is not, what is the reason, and ultimately made into this deliberation here. Now, okay, so when I say these days, the climate change is one of the hot topics these days. the rapid population growth, industrialization, and utilization of fossil fuels at a very faster rate has led to the accumulation of greenhouse gas in the atmosphere and ultimately leading to global climate change. These things. Now, global climate change has come into such a situation now, we cannot take it anymore. So we have to keep a full stop for it. So the best option is entering into the renewable energy. Now, the only solution is the solution for this climatic change is the renewable energy. So renewable energy like solar, hydel, tidal, wind, and biomass is one of the important options for it. Now, when we see in Indian situation, the biogas, when we look into the Indian situation, government of India is now spending a lot of money and a new ministry called Ministry of New Renewable, New and Renewable Energy is there, which spends a lot of money for our renewable energy resources, basically. So this is the status of now in India, the current status of the renewable energy, basically the wind, hydel, small hydel plants, biopower, and the solar power. Now, for India has got a very high potential for solar, wind, and the biomass, basically. When you talk of biomass, the biomass basically ethanol, biogas, biohydrogen. So this is not only for small residential houses, but we should work more on a larger scale, big plants has to be there for the biogas thing. Thereby, we can extract ethanol, biohydrogen, biohydrogen. We can extract it. So we should work on such type of things. We should do. Government is moving towards that side, right? Now, when we look about the biogas in India, the great crisis is seen in the rural India, basically, that too in domestic sector. So the main cause of the rural people's problem for the fuel is they use the dirty fuel, which I would say that the solid biomass, that is fuel wood, coal, cow dung cakes, and agricultural residues are used a lot. Thereby, it creates indoor air pollution. And moreover, when we look into it, in indoor air pollution, for combating it, one way is that utilizing the waste to energy technology. So whatever the waste is there, through the waste, we can produce biogas. Right. Now, from the waste means like what are the waste which we generally see in the rural India is dairy waste, number one. Then the agricultural residues. Then household residues, that is basically which we can pull it generally as a municipal waste, like all these waste can be utilized to produce biogas in a condition which is generally called as the anaerobic condition. So when we look into how biogas is being formed, the biogas is basically formed in four stages, that is called as the hydrolysis, acidogenesis, acetogenesis, and methanogenesis. Now, when we see the hydrolysis portion, whatever we say the organic matter, basically the waste which I'm talking about is about the biodegradable waste which is generated. The biodegradable waste basically consists of carbohydrates, proteins, fats, and other things. Now, they are basically broken down into monomers by a simple hydrolysis process. By microorganisms play important role, and the same different another set of microorganisms which convert these monomers into short chain volatile fatty acids. Now these bacteria, these short chain fatty short chain fatty acids or volatile organic acids gets converted to acetates and by a process called acetogenesis. Basically, acetates are produced. It could be basically acetates. Now, these acetates are converted to methane by methanogenesis. So, these are the four stages which are there. Now, and for this, we need one very important precondition, which is the temperature and the pH of it. The pH should be between 6.5 to 7, and the temperature should be 35 to 40 degree or maximum 41 degree, roughly around 40 degrees, you can say. Thereby, we can have an enhanced biogas production. Right. Now, okay. Now, in India, when we see what is the biogas potential, what are the biogas potential inside? So, as I said, the solution for rural India is utilizing the cow dung. Now, when we see what is the amount of bovine population in India, it is very, very high. So, it is roughly 306 million of bovine population is there. And when we say like per cow can produce roughly 20 to 25 kg of cow dung it can produce. And from 1 kg of cow dung, we can produce roughly 40 liters of biogas we can produce. Now, when I say biogas basically consists of methane, which is between 40 to 50% in our cow dung we get it, 40 to 50% or maximum it goes up to 55%. Then 20 to 30% of carbon dioxide and rest is roughly hydrogen sulfide is there and nitrogen is there, slightly ammonia is there and water vapor is present. So this is what the biogas generally consists. So when I say the cow dung, 1 kg of cow dung produces roughly 40 liters of biogas it can produce. So one cow can produce roughly 800 to 1000 ml of biogas it can produce. So when I say 1000 ml of biogas, which is equivalent to 1 cubic meter, 1 cubic meter is sufficient enough for 3 times cooking in a small nuclear family of 3 to 4 persons. So if it is a nuclear family, I would suggest that one cow is sufficient to produce enough of biogas for their 3 times cooking. So think for all over India, it is 305 million cow are present, which is roughly 30% of world's bovine population is in India. So it can produce roughly 980 million tons of cattle dung per year. And then it can, when we say it in methane content, roughly like 48,000 million cubic meter of biogas can be generated annually. It can be generated. So when we talk of energy terms, it is roughly 70 gigajoules of energy annually we can do it. Now, apart from this bovine, we can enhance these biogas productions, as I said, by using co-digestion. Co-digestion is nothing but when we use cow dung as an inoculum, that is for bacteria and other things, because the whole biogas process is done by bacteria. With this, we can add another substrates like, as I said, water hyacinth, salvinia, terrestrial weeds even like parthenium, food waste, agricultural waste like rice straw, wheat straw, whatever waste is there, we can just put into it and we can have more biogas and we can have more methane. Now, what are the various types of biogas plants in India? Now, when we say in India, there are basically 4 types of biogas plants are present. Like the first one is fixed dome plants. This is also called as the Dinabandhu model, where in the underground, we have a cemented structures and we have a small dome. And in the dome, the biogas is being collected. reactor, and from here the exhaust is there, exhaust pipe is there, which can be used for kitchen. So from here we can put a waste inlet inside. So here we have got, which we call it as a hydraulic retention time, that is the amount the slurry should be present inside. So if it is here for roughly 15 days, you will have enough of biogas would be produced initially. Now whenever the biogas is digested, so here we can add the input of the biogas, the cow dung, you can put it inside, and then after digestion the slurry can go outside here. Now the slurry is one of an excellent material which can be used for agricultural purposes. So whenever we talk of biogas, whenever we talk of cow dung, we think cow dung as two things. One is we think it as a fertilizer. We make it compost, put it in the agricultural field. The other option is we make it as a cow dung cake and use it as a fuel wood. So we use it for two purposes. One is either as a fuel or as an fertilizer. But when we put this cow dung into the biogas plant, we get both the things. We get fuel as well as we get a fertilizer. Right. So this is one of the most common biogas plant which is present in India, which is the fixed dome plant or a Dinabandhu model, we call it. Second is a floating drum. So the floating drum, what we have it here, it is like what a down chamber it is here. And then above we have one iron container which floats on it. As the biogas is being produced inside, what occurs, the dome floats, and then from here we can collect the gas. So this is a floating dome. Generally the floating dome is made up of iron or a steel material, and here also you get an exhaust. The slurry, we can get it here. This is an inlet and this is the outlet here. And the third one is the low-cost polythene tubes. So this is basically used in South Africa and in African and in Latin American countries this is used. This one under the balloon plant, these two are not very common in India. But nowadays, the MNRE tries these types of balloon plants. It is quite cheaper for making it. Right. Now, what are the advantages of biogas? Now, biogas is basically a renewable energy source, number one, and it prevents pollution, basically the water pollution, the soil pollution can be decreased, and it can give a very good economic effect because farmers, especially, they can get fuel and they can get fertilizer. Both the things they can get it. And when we look into the environmental impact of it, it helps to the wood is being protected by this, thereby deforestation can be stopped, and we get good energy as well by this biogas. And then lastly, the waste management. When we talk of waste management, whatever the waste which is produced in the village is being, you can utilize it in the biogas plant for production of biogas. Now, what are the various programs initiated by Government of India for the biogas, regarding biogas? Now, in 1981, Government of India, in a 6th 5-year plan, they started the national project on biogas development in the Department of Non-Conventional Energy Source. And then in 1985 to 90, they started a biogas crash program. That is, here roughly 1.5 million biogas plants were installed during this period, 1985 to 90. Right. And then biogas power off-grid program was started in 2006 for the small-scale dairy farmers and rural industries. Here, the biogas plant was between 25 to 85 cubic meters. This is for the power generation they have given. And slowly, it was even made into a larger thing for 200 cubic meters. It has been made for thermal application and bio-based power generation. And in 2017, now the new national biogas and organic manure management program was started. Now, under this program, roughly 5 million family-sized biogas plants were installed. Now, one of the major problems associated with the family-sized biogas plant is that they use it for 1 year or 2 years, and afterwards they stop using it. While government gives a lot of subsidy for it. Now, for making a 1 cubic meter plant, government gives a subsidy of 7,500 rupees. For 2 to 6 cubic meter biogas plant, it gives roughly 12,000 rupees. Now, if you want to construct a new biogas plant of 1 cubic meter, it comes roughly 25 to 30,000 rupees you have to spend for construction of it. Now, basically, what after 1 year or 2 years, why do people stop using it? Now, when people stop using it, others also follow that. When he used it, he didn't find it very useful. So why should I invest so much amount of money into it? Now, we will see what are the various barriers which are generally present in adoption of the biogas system. The first one is household expenditure. Now, 50% of the rural people in India, their monthly income is less than 10,000 rupees. So, for adoption of renewable energy, it's very limited to them. Because as the income increases, clean energy increases, utilization increases. So the low income group has got a financial difficulty in acquiring the biogas plants. Right. When we talk of energy ladder theory, the energy transition of the household income increases, the cleaner energy source increases. So what is the ultimate solution? So the ultimate solution is nothing but to break the poverty cycle. But I know breaking a poverty cycle is very, very difficult. It's a vicious cycle. Now, we can see that the people with the higher income can afford clean energy, while the lower energy cannot go for it because the construction cost is very high. Now, what another solution is that we can give them a low-cost biogas plant, which would cost roughly 7,000 to 8,000 rupees, you can say. Now, like an example, we have thought is like giving two syntex tank. Now, if two syntex tank is there, one can be a digester and other can be a collector for biogas. Or like you can make the same thing as a floating dome. Now, you can cut the top of the biogas plant in one. In another thing, both the things you can cut it. And then in one, you can put it as the slurry with the input. And you can invert the syntex tank and cover on the top of it. Thereby, it will be acting like a floating dome. So one 750 ml of syntex tank would cost roughly 3,000 rupees. So within 6,000 rupees, you can have one small plant and extra connection fittings would be coming roughly 1,000 rupees more. So within 7,000 rupees, I think one small 750 cubic meter of 750 ml of a biogas plant, you can get it. That is 0.75 cubic meter of biogas plant, you can get it. So this type of small things, when we do it, we can try using this to break the vicious cycle. But I know breaking the vicious cycle is very difficult. Second is the livestock population. Now, Government of India has got a rule that if you need a subsidy for construction of a biogas plant, you should have a minimum of 2 to 3 cows. Now, those things were there when it was a joint family. Now, no more joint family. All are nuclear family. In nuclear family, maximum, they are very difficult to maintain even single cow. So, if single cow is there, it is very difficult for them to run a biogas plant. This is what government of India administrates. But frankly speaking, one cow, if it is there, that would be sufficient for that small nuclear family. It might not be sufficient for a joint family, but for a nuclear family, it is sufficient. As I mentioned, that one cow, if it is a buffalo, you can have roughly, say, 40 kg of cow dung, you can get it. And then it can produce roughly 1.2 cubic meter of biogas it can produce. So livestock is one of the issue in getting the and in barrier for getting loans and adoption of the biogas plants. The third is gender participation. Now, when we say gender, like the women's labor in India is considered very low by the male household member. It's a general consideration. So, and it is the male member of the family who thinks whether he can invest into the clean fuel or what. So the women decision-making power in a rural society is meager, thereby leading into a lower investment into a clean fuels. So the solution is that the women's education plays a very important role in adoption and utilization of the biogas. And even the age and gender also plays a very important role. If women are not that much educated, or if they are older, which we have seen it in the village, in Shaila, we have seen it, that the women, the older women and uneducated women, they are more comfortable and attached with the traditional cooking practice. And they are less motivated by adoption of very clean fuel, ignoring the health effects of the air pollution, basically the health effects of the indoor air pollution. Then the social stigma. Now, when we talk of the social stigma, people the foul odor which is being generated, or the unhygienic condition which is generated in their household area, because the bioslurry, when it comes out in a liquid thing where it gives a very ugly look. So people don't prefer such things. And some more traditional societies, they don't prefer any food, any fuel material which is being produced from the fecal matter, let it be cow dung, or let it be poultry dung, or let it be pig, or whatever it is, they don't want it. Now, when we see only in India, we have got such things. Now, moreover in India, think about it, is one of the big populous country. Now, human fecal matter is also one of an very good source of energy, which can produce huge amount of biogas. Now in India, the social stigma is there. It is a taboo. No one can even think of getting a biogas from the human feces. But in abroad, and even in Bangladesh, biogas plants are there, which is being produced by the community toilets. Huge biogas are being produced, and then huge income is generated from it. Right. Then the next barrier I would suggest is the maintenance. The longevity and the willingness to uptake a biogas technology depends on the maintenance. Right. So the biogas has to be maintained frequently if you need complete and then full-fledged support from the cow dung. And we see here the longevity of the biogas plants depends on the technical knowledge, installation, and operation of it. And all the three, there is problems. Now, if technical studies state that if a biogas plant is well constructed and well maintained, its lifetime is between 20 to 30 years, which can give. Right. And then one of the main reasons for non-functionality of the biogas is improper installation. construction defect. And then low awareness is being given to the families who are utilizing the biogas plant. Till now, they don't know how to mix the cow dung and water, how much cow dung to give, how much water to be added. They don't know. They still think that if the cow slurry is thick, we get more biogas. It is not the same. It should be within 1:1 ratio, but people don't do it. And then proper mixing should be there. It's not given. It's not done. So moreover, after construction, the maintenance is to be done by KVIC or the state nodal agency for biogas development and training center. They hardly visit the site. Once government installs it, after install, they check it, they see that, okay, biogas is produced, then they just go off. After 1 month or 2 months, they should just come for a review, whether it is really working or not, that is not done. Then the next important barrier is the feedstock. Now, generally in rural India, when we see the feedstock is a cow dung. And not only cow dung can be used, we can use sewage, municipal solid waste, crop residues like bagasse, that is the sugarcane waste, which and the agricultural waste all have a very high potential to produce biogas. Now, when I say the methane content varies from feedstock to feedstock. Like when a cattle manure, it can maximum have methane content up to 65%. Poultry might contain up to 60%. Pig contains 65% of methane it can produce. While kitchen waste can give 50% of methane. While water hyacinth can give rise to 52% of methane. So, right. So the methane content depends on the feedstock, what feedstock we are using. Right. And the next barrier is the skill and the knowledge. Now, the challenge of biogas adoption lies in a low number of companies which are specialized in biogas things. Now, the qualified and the specialized persons are also very, very little. So, similarly, the construction guys are also very, very limited. If any problem comes in, it's very difficult to repair the biogas plants because the design, construction, everything is very, very crucial in the biogas plant. So this technology is only with the limited companies and with only very few persons know the knowledge or know-how of it. And the household, basically the women and the men folk have very little training and education to add appropriate, to select the appropriate feedstock. And they are not fully aware of the biogas digesters. They know that if we put cow dung into it, we get biogas. That's it. Nothing more. They don't know how they should think that we should get more biogas and things like that. Right. And then the failure and negative perception is one of the very crucial thing, this thing. Now, if I have a biogas plant and if there is a crack arises, what I do is I abandon it. Now, I might use it for 2 years. After 2 years, I abandoned it. I have invested almost 25,000 into it. Now, my neighbor who has also have got a cow, after seeing the same situation, hey, this guy had a biogas plant and then now he's not using it. Why should I invest almost 20,000 of rupees, though I get a subsidy from government? I'm not going to use it. So this is one of the negative perception which we generally observe. And then the proper technical know-how has to be there. Why it is not working? That has to be developed. And then the market barriers. Now, when I say market barrier, as I said, that it is basically the biogas plant is basically a monopoly market, which we see here now. Now, in our rural village at Uttar Chelai, we had a biogas plant. We installed a new one. And then we were looking for the the stove, biogas stove. We could not get it anywhere in the local market. And ultimately, we have to go to Dubrajpur to get the biogas stove. And that too at a very high rate. So in India, we don't have a proper this monopoly has to be broken. That's what I would suggest that. And then in developing countries, the biogas as a traditional fuel as their competitor. And then it is one of the cheap and readily available. So people would say that when I have a readily available fuel, why should I go for it? But those people, we should make them aware that this traditional fuel is harmful to you, your family, because of the hazardous indoor air pollution. Right. And then the digestate, whatever it is being produced, has only very small shelf life. It is in the liquid state. Now, this liquid state, the farmers prefer that it's in the slurry. Now, how will I take this slurry to my field? I can't take it. If it is a cow dung, I could take it into my field. But here, they should think that now the slurry, whatever it is there, they can add a value to it and they can convert this bio slurry into vermicompost, and then they can enhance their livelihood. Now, when it becomes vermicompost, then they can take it to their field, they can sell it, they can start a new business as well. So this is one market barrier which I find it. And other is the no one sells the biogas. Now, there is no market for biogas in India. Now, suppose I have four cow, I can produce more biogas. Now, what I can do is we can make aware that the people that you buy 1 liter biogas bags are there, they can fill the biogas and sell it to the local market. Because 1 cubic meter of biogas, that would be sufficient for 1 day cooking of a normal household. So these types there is no market for this thing. So we have to develop market for biogas selling as well, and these biogas bags are reusable one as well. Now, when we look into the technical barriers, the water is one of the most important technical barrier here, because we need to mix water in the ratio of 1:1, where the water is scarce, we can't work with the biogas plants. And the biogas have got lots of impurities which are present. Now, impurities like nitrogen, hydrogen sulfide. Now, hydrogen sulfide is severe corrosive gas. Now, how we have to go for this technical? Now, these type of small technical issues only we have to make them aware. Now, if we have found out that the buffalo dung has got more hydrogen sulfide when compared to the cow dung. Now, if you have buffalo dung and if more hydrogen sulfide is being produced, you can add a bit of ferric chloride. Now, this ferric chloride will remove all the hydrogen sulfide which is being produced there. And then the treatment of the waste, whatever it is there. Now, as I said, that the technical barrier is that when they go for utilizing straw or water hyacinth or weeds, it should be properly treated. Means like a pre-treatment is required. So we have to work on it. Now, we have given training and we have even given them awareness about how to treat these water hyacinth, salvinia, parthenium, and the rice straw and other things. It is very simple thing. Like you have to pre-digest it. Pre-digest it means what? All the lignin, everything should get dissolved in it. So we have to add more bacteria. Now, how we can do it? We can take a jaggery, lime, cow urine. You can mix it and you can put those things and keep it for 1 week. In this, if we do it like this, all the lignin, everything gets decomposed at a very faster rate. Then you can put it you can mix it with the cow dung and put it into the biogas plant, and thereby you can enhance the biogas production. So these type of technical barriers are there. Now these technical barriers should be only cleared by the common awareness program has to be given to them. Now the environmental constraint is one of the crucial thing I will suggest that, because leakages is very common in biogas plant, and we know methane is does not cause any health hazards to human being, but it is one of the potent greenhouse gas. It has got 25 times higher potential greenhouse potential when compared to carbon dioxide. And during summer, when biogas production is very high, what occurs is maximum leakage occurs. When you fit the pipe just slips out, or in the pipe you will find cracks would be coming. And if we don't utilize the biogas regularly, what occurs? Crack occurs on the tank itself, on the fixed dome, and thereby leakage occurs. So and if leakage occurs, it is more harmful to the environment, right? And then if you are abandoning any biogas plant, now whatever the slurry which is present there, which contains more amount of ammonia, nitrate, everything, they leach into the groundwater and cause groundwater contamination as well, right? So these are some of the technical barriers, I think, which we can discuss it, which we should discuss it with the local people, and we should create awareness to them as well. And then the institutional barrier, when we look into the institutional barrier, like Government of India tells that minimum 1 to 2 cattle is required for pre-treatment for biogas loan and other things. So I think government should say that okay, one cow is sufficient. So that type of things, and then the massive subsidies which is being given by government, like for LPG and other things. Now this because they are very cheaper and they go for those things, and they don't opt for clean energy. So this competition, like government should promote more clean fuel rather than conventional fuels type of things. And then proper dissemination of the biogas technology should be proper. And then the most important is that just government giving a loan is not alone sufficient. After loan, they should come and check it whether it is working properly, if there is any problem. All the nodal officers for it should have a check on it. So then only it would be we could come out with the solution for the biogas adoption. We can go for it. Now, when we look into these things, there is a severe interrelationship between all the barriers which I have discussed. Now, when I say the socioeconomic factors like markets, outreach activity, livestock, feedstock, they are ultimately even the gender participation, then technical issues, institutional barrier, maintenance, all are interrelated, giving rise to the less adoption and failures of the biogas plants. Right. Now, when we look into the biogas thing, biogas is one of the excellent beneficial things which is required now. Which is required right now. Now, when we say this biogas thing, we say that this is one of the very important thing for the sustainable development. Now, when I say the economic development, like the sustainable development 1, 2, and 8. Sustainable development 1 tells that no poverty, 2 is zero hunger, and 3 is a decent work and economic growth. When I say no poverty means you get a very good fertilizer. Now, when you get fertilizer, you can make it into vermicompost, thereby you can enhance your livelihood. Thereby, no poverty, you can achieve it. No hunger. Now, utilize these fertilizer or the vermicompost into agriculture, thereby your no hunger aim can be achieved, because it contains very high N, nitrogen, potassium, and phosphorus is very high in it. And decent work and economic growth, you can get it a thing. Like you can utilize the waste, whatever it is waste, you can utilize it. And you can reduce the carbon footprint. You can reduce it. Now, when we look into the social thing, Sustainable Development Goal 3, Goal 4, Goal 5, and Goal 11. Now, when I say Goal 3, it is a good health and well-being. Now, when we use biogas, we can say that the indoor air pollution is reduced, thereby good health and well-being is there. Now, when good energy is produced, Sustainable Development Goal 4, which is good education, you can provide them. Now, Sustainable Development 5 tells about gender equality. When in a house, when there is a biogas plant is there, it means that the females is being given more importance. And the women and the children are taken equal responsibility. Means the male gives equal rights to the female. They think about their health and other things. So gender equality comes in Sustainable Development 5. Now, when I say Sustainable Development Goal level, means sustainable cities and communities. Now, when we use the whatever the waste which is being generated in cities and in communities, it is ultimately utilized in the biogas plant. I think these cities and communities would be very clean, and thereby Sustainable Development Goal 11 is getting achieved. Now, overall, when we look into the environment, now Sustainable Development Goal 6, 7, 12, and 13 can be achieved when we use biogas. Now, when we say Sustainable Development Goal 6 means clean water and sanitation. Now, for example, a pond is being polluted by water hyacinth or salvinia. You can use it, and you can use it for a clean water and sanitation. So the cow dung, whatever it is there, you can put it into it, thereby the clean environment would be there, right? And then Sustainable Development 7 tells about clean, affordable energy. Now, when biogas is there, we get a very clean energy, you get it. And then responsible consumption and production. So what we are doing is we are utilizing the natural resource, thereby reducing air and water pollution. And we are even recycling the waste, we are doing it. So thereby Sustainable Development Goal 12 also comes into it. And overall Sustainable Goal 13, which tells about the climate action. Now, when I say the methane and the if you don't use the waste and other things, it gets dumped elsewhere, and ultimately huge amount of methane is released into the environment from the sanitary waste and other things, landfills and other things. So if you can convert it into biogas, I think Sustainable Goal 13, you can get it. So overall, when I would like to conclude that these biogas caters the Sustainable Development Goals. And then the end users, that is the villagers and the communities which are using, needs to be more responsible towards the government program. Whenever they give subsidy, it should be properly, they should utilize it. And then for them, the environmental awareness has to be created. Thereby, they have to utilize the resources, whatever they have given, properly. While before the government agencies, they should have a feedback mechanism. Just giving subsidy alone is not sufficient to check the implementation, and sustainability has to be checked in. And I would like to acknowledge all the faculty members and scholars who worked in the DST-sponsored Indo-UK, the Bridging Urban, Rural and Urban Divide Bird Project, and the BBSRC-sponsored Bioenergy, Fertilizer, Clean Water from the Invasive Aquatic Macrophytes BFAM Project. Thank you. Thank you very much for your patience listening. Any questions? To make it larger. Stop it.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Balachandran. It was a wonderful presentation. And now it's time for interactions. And I request our listeners to respond to Dr. Balachandran's presentation. If you have any queries, you can write in the chat box, or you can also directly ask a question to Dr. Balachandran. And if you, sir, if you don't mind, if you can go through the chat box, you see if you want to respond to any queries.
Okay, yeah.
Kushinda, you are muted.
I don't think there is any query. I can't see here. Any.
Yeah, I also could not see any queries.
Yeah, that's why I said if anyone of you, those who are listening, you can directly talk to Dr. Balachandran if you have any queries. Please do so.
Well, just in case, if there's no question, so can I come in? I mean, I just want to ask. I mean, it's a question from a layman like me, because I have really, really meager amount of knowledge regarding these type of discussions which you have made. But I would like to say that, it's a really insightful and informative, particularly the persons like us who want to know, but who don't have any kind of formal education regarding these subjects. And one technical question right from my end.
Yeah.
So at the beginning, if I'm not mistaken, at the beginning of your slides, probably where you have shown those bars, the bar plots.
Yeah.
Well, along y-axis, can you please so along y-axis is the y-axis unit free? That's
this is in number, so this is also in millions only.
So I have spotted only the numbers.
Okay, so this is in millions.
So millions means so, it's a count. It's a count.
Yeah, it's a count. It's a count. It's a data from our veterinary from the Indian livestock census.
Okay, that sounds good.
Because we have got a very huge bovine population in India. Yeah. That is the thing. But we hardly use these things. It is just used only as a cow manure. Now, instead of using it as just a cow manure, you can convert this cow manure into vermicompost, and then you can increase the price of it. This would be one of an excellent way of source of income. Because when we say a tractor, say 1,500 to 1,800 kg of cow dung will come roughly 2,500 to 3,000 rupees. The same thing if it is a 1 kg of, means like say, if you say it is 1 kg, it would be hardly 1,800 kg would be roughly 2,000, 3,000. See what is the price of it? Like 1 kg of vermicompost, when we say it is roughly 20 to 25 rupees, you get it. So the price is very high when you make it into vermicompost, but such type of thing, they should do it. And since labor is to be given into it, and people are not that much interested to put labor into it.
Okay. Yes, I got your point. Okay. So that's just a trivial query right from my end. Thank you so very much. Okay. So passing on to Parthoda.
Yeah. Okay. Dr. Balachandran, I was just thinking locally whether is there any biogas generation system in Birbhum as such? Do you have any knowledge about that?
No, we don't have a overall big, huge biogas generation system is not there. If you want to see in Visva-Bharati, we have one biogas plant, which can produce roughly 20 cubic meter of biogas. We have it. And we have in the bird project, we have made it. It's in Pearsonpally. It is there behind it, behind the girls' hostel. It is there. You can just have a look at it. There the energy is generated. We have integrated solar and the biogas is integrated into it. And then whatever the energy which is being generated by the biogas, by genset, we convert it into electricity and store it in the battery. Yeah. If we need it, we can give it to the rural people. So we have made it in such a way Yeah.
Right. Okay. So I guess there is no question left. So finally, it's... our heartfelt thanks to you, Dr. Balachandran, for giving time and a wonderful presentation.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
For a vote of thanks. And we are extremely grateful to our Honorable Vice Chancellor for his constant support and encouragement. In fact, this dialogic is his brainchild. So thank you very much, sir, for your constant support. We are extremely delighted to have Professor Biparsha Raha as the mentor of our group. Her grace and depth always adds value to our group, and she always gives us encouragement to go on and think anew. So thank you, Biparshadi, for your constant support. We are also thankful to Arpan Mukherjee from Kala Bhavan for creating such wonderful flyers, and how wonderfully he reacts or responds to every time we have a lecture, and he comes out with something new. That's wonderful. Thank you very much, Mr. Arpan Mukherjee. And thanks to our technical team led by Dr. Koshi Ghosh of the Central Library. Sometimes we face technical glitches, as today. I had to rush out from my home to come to Central Library to have this done, right? So thank you, Koshikda, for making it possible. We also acknowledge deeply the support of that we got from the Vice Chancellor's office and also from the office of the Register. And finally, all the committee members of the dialogue for their constant suggestions and cooperations. And, hope to get your company soon. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you, Partho. Thank you, Balachandran, Koshi. Yeah. Thanks. And thanks to all the team members.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Didi. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.